focal hepatic mass in pediatric. So the points I'm going to cover in this whole slide will be, first I will discuss with the common liver pathologies in neonates and the focal hepatic masses in pediatrics, the whole spectrum of the focal hepatic mass that I will just brief, and some benign tumors which are very common, and that will be in detail, and malignant tumors in detail. So first I'll cover neonatal liver pathologies. So the most important neonatal liver pathologies are always jaundice. The child present inborn jaundice, born with the jaundice. So then I'll covering the tumors, the vascular anomalies and the acquired disease. So in the cholestatic jaundice, mainly biliary atresia, neonatal hepatitis, colloidal cysts. In neonatal liver pathologies, the important thing was jaundice. Causes of important causes of jaundice is biliary atresia, neonatal hepatitis and colloidal cysts. There are many lot of causes, but these we have to important radiologically. In the tumors, infantile hemangioma, mesenchymal hematomas and hepatoblastomas, I will discuss later.
So these are not neonatal, right? The tumors are pediatric.
Only the cholestasis. And the vascular anomalies, the arteriovenous malformations, and acquired disease in the neonates related to the umbilical artery catheterizations. So the definition of the pathological jaundice, when should be considered it is a jaundice, not physiological. So first 24 hours, rise of the bilirubin more than 5 milligram in 24 hours, direct bilirubin level more than 1 milligram, or persistence of the new onset jaundice even after 2 weeks, that we have already learned in MBBS. So basically the patient, the neonates, the child is sent for to us for USG to rule out important cause of cholestatic jaundice, that are biliary atresia, neonatal hepatitis and colloidal cysts. These we have to differentiate whether it is due to the biliary atresia or colloidal cysts with the hepatitis. So I will first discussing about the biliary atresia in detail. So it is 1 in 10 into 1900, the male-female ratio is 2:1. So the cause of the biliary atresia according to the etiopathogenesis is viral-induced, immune-mediated. And some say it is abnormal morphogenesis of ductal plate. So ductal plate is basically help in the development of the bile duct. So abnormal morphogenesis lead to the biliary atresia. It is very important to diagnose early, because if undiagnosed, then it will lead to cirrhosis for the death by 2 years. So biliary atresia has to be ruled out if there is a neonatal hepatitis. So the types of the biliary atresia, we have categorized 3 types of biliary atresia: the focal one, intrahepatic and extrahepatic biliary atresia. So the most commonest one is extrahepatic biliary atresia. So extrahepatic biliary atresia will be atresia of the common bile duct is the extrahepatic biliary atresia. And then subtypes of the extrahepatic biliary atresia will be subtype 1, that is perinatal type, that presents late in the fetal life and the postnatally. So jaundice develop after regression of the physiological jaundice. It's not at the birth. Extrahepatic biliary atresia subtype 1 will be after the physiological jaundice. And bile duct remnant is seen in the porta hepatis. I will discuss the ultrasound feature of extrahepatic, how you will diagnose it. So subtype 2 is jaundice at birth. It is the normal decline in the bilirubin level never occur. So in perinatal period there is jaundice, and the bachu present jaundice at birth. It is associated with multiple congenital anomalies like polysplenia, intestinal malrotation. So subtype 1 will be basically after the resolution of the physiological jaundice, and subtype 2 will be associated embryonic type, fetal type, that will be associated with other congenital anomalies like polysplenia, that we have to look for. So what are the ultrasound features to diagnose biliary atresia? So the first is the echogenicity. It can be raised, it can be normal. There is decreased visualization of the peripheral portal venous vasculature, because in biliary atresia of bachus there is fibrosis happens, so the portal venous system in the periphery will decrease. There is a sign which is called a triangular cord sign. So triangular cord sign is basically at the level of the division of portal vein there is a increased echogenicity. There is a tubular structure with increased echogenicity, that is the remnant of the biliary atresia, CBD that is. So if it is echogenic at the level of the division of the portal vein, this we can suspect there is a portal vein, there is a CBD, this remnant of the CBD which is not formed. And we have to look for the gallbladder. There is abnormal shape of the gallbladder. So abnormal shape is that is length more than the breadth. So the gallbladder size would not be normal, the length will be more than the breadth. And the other thing is, we ask the mother to feed the child, and then we again repeat the ultrasound. So if there is change in the size of the gallbladder after feeding, that means there is secretion of the bile juice. That means the CBD is patent. There has to be change in the gallbladder size. And the other last thing is increase in the hepatic artery portal vein ratio. So what happens, the hepatic artery size, normally we visualize hepatic artery less than the portal vein diameter, but hepatic artery increases, it hypertrophies, it increases then the portal vein. So these we have to look for, the three things. And if we are suspecting that subtype 2, that biliary atresia, then we have to look for the other congenital anomalies like polysplenia, which is associated with biliary atresia in 10 to 20% cases. And then if the child has already progressed with the biliary atresia, then signs of the end stage liver disease. So all these features will help in the diagnosis of the biliary atresia. On Doppler ultrasound, again, hepatic artery to the portal vein diameter are greater in biliary atresia. We can perform, if ultrasound is like not diagnosing it, then we can perform hepatobiliary scintigraphy. That radionuclide dye is injected, and then if it is excreted in the duodenum through the CBD, then we can say the CBD is functioning. And MR imaging, that is cholangiography, MRCP can well visualize the track, CBD track. Elastography basically, because of the high fibrosis, there will be elastography changes, heart changes. Other one variant of this bile atresia is a cystic. So it can be seen, there is a cyst seen centrally that mimics the appearance of the type 1 colon. So this is a picture. If we are seeing a cyst in the near the porta hepatis, then we can confuse this with this colectal cyst. But if the other features like the triangular cord sign I told you, if the GB is abnormal, if there is no change in the size after feeding up, and if there is echogenic, that remnant of the CBD, then this is a variant which is cystic atresia, biliary atresia. So other features we have to consider to differentiate it from colidocal cyst. There is one Allagill syndrome. Allagill syndrome is basically, there is hypogenesis of the CBD and hypogenesis of the intrahepatic biliary duct, and with the other congenital anomalies. Other congenital anomalies like characteristic facies, cholestasis, congenital cardiac defects. So this is a syndrome basically. If clinically all these features, one out of five, if the three features are present along with the features of biliary atresia on ultrasound, then we can suspect Allagill syndrome. So now I had covered this basically the biliary atresia portion, that neonatal liver pathologies. Neonatal hepatitis will be just the other causes of the jaundice. That will be viral cause. If we have already ruled out this biliary atresia, then and colidocal cyst, then we can suspect neonatal hepatitis. So ultrasound features are normal CBD, normal liver.
So you know, when patient will come to you with jaundice, you basically have to look for the gallbladder and that triangular cord sign. These are basically the two things you have to look for. It's otherwise very difficult to differentiate clinically between the two. It's not very uncommon to find colidocal cysts. So when I was doing my residency, I've seen at least three kids with colidocal cysts. And some of them are incidental, they don't even have jaundice. So you just incidental, there'll be a lump in the abdomen, they'll come for that. And sometimes they can come with jaundice. So they can happen as neonates if they come with jaundice, or even later on, 2 year, 3 year, 4. If you see that cystic thing, like what the photo shows, your cyst in the region of the phylum basically, which is obviously not vascular, then always, almost certainly is going to be a colorectal cyst. So, you know, it's something you don't think on ultrasound generally, right? But it does happen. Look for the gallbladder very carefully. Okay, you have to have patience. If you don't see it now, call them again after some time. So if you have some patience, obviously best thing is when the patient, baby is not fed for some time. That's when you have the maximum chance of seeing the gallbladder. So it takes some time. The triangular cord is a nice described sign, but not very easy to catch. You know, depending on the orientation of a probe, anything can look like a triangle. You know, so it's not an easy sign to find. So gallbladder plus this, both of them are important. It will take, you know, some time for you to get used to what is normal, what is abnormal. So unless you have very dedicated pediatric practice, confidence will be there. So I think gallbladder is the simplest thing. It's a big gallbladder which, you know, collapses later on after feeds. That's like easy, then it's done.
So now I'm starting with the focal hepatic masses. So focal hepatic masses are any SOL in the liver. So it will be congenital masses like hepatic cysts, polydocal cysts, the primary neoplasm like infantile hemangiomas, adenomas. Adenomas are then again in the younger children, like seen in the young adults. FNH, mesenchymal hematoma, regenerative nodule, hepatoblastoma, HCC. So metastatic disease, always from this neuroblastoma and the Wilms tumor, infective causes, and the some condition that can mimic like the focal fatty infiltration, hepatic infarction and all. So I'll discussing the important ones. So in the category of benign tumors, the important ones are infantile hemangioendothelioma, the mesenchymal hematoma, FNH, hepatocellular adenoma, nodular regenerative hyperplasia. So the most important and the most commonest thing, the neonate present, child present, is infantile hemangiomas. So infantile hemangiomas are basically vascular neoplasms. These are the most common benign hepatic tumor of the infancy, and their characteristic is they proliferate and then they involute, like the one in the cutaneous hemangiomas, the cavernous hemangiomas. They also proliferate and they involute by the age of 1 year. So it is first diagnosed in the first year only. It is benign, but the important thing is we have to diagnose it because serious clinical complications may occur. That I will discuss later. And the hemangioendothelioma or infantile hemangioma, you can use it interchangeably, the term. So they have classified infantile hemangioma into three parts, the multifocal, focal and the diffuse. And this is just a GLUT1 based on the GLUT1 receptor positivity. So basically they have said that multifocal lesions, infantile hemangiomas are GLUT1 positive, others are GLUT1 negative. I will discuss it in detail. So a case, there is a 6-month-old girl with abdominal distension. She presented with abdominal distension. Here is the liver picture. So ultrasound suggestive of the multiple hypoechoic small similar size lesions, sub-centimeter, centimeter size lesions. The Doppler said there is a vascularity peripherally around the lesions. CT said, plain CT said, there is a hypodense, multiple hypodense lesion. It enhances uniformly. All the small tiny nodules, they enhances uniformly. So on MRI, the T2 weighted images, it shows bright hyperintensity, multiple nodules. T1 weighted images, the hypointense, and post contrast it enhances. So all the, so this is basically multifocal infantile hemangiomas. So these hemangiomas are basically tiny, around 1 centimeter in size, multiple, both lobes of liver affected, and they enhances homogeneously. So another case, 6 week old boy with painless abdominal mass. So there is, it presents with painless abdominal mass. Here is the ultrasound picture. So I'm just saying, basically this is the I'll show you the case first. So this is the mass on the plain CT, and then it enhances on the arterial phase peripherally, and on delayed phase it centripetally fills in. So this is basically infantile this focal infantile hemangioma. It is solitary, it is large, it like in the adults we see there is a non-confluent peripheral enhancement with centripetal filling. So this is the same picture, and the it never fills in the center because there are necrotic hemorrhagic areas in the center. So it centripetally fills in, but like in the adult part it completely fills in the center, but in the child part, because there is a necrosis and hemorrhage, so there is always necrotic areas. And I am trying to show you the hepatic veins. There are dilated hepatic veins. What happens in the focal infantile hemangiomas? There are arteriovenous communications. So there is dilated branch of the celiac artery, that is hepatic artery, and there is dilation of the hepatic vein also. So there is arteriovenous communication in this mass. That is why on Doppler also, if you do Doppler on artery, then you will see there is low resistance flow basically because of the arteriovenous communication. So hence the complication also occurs, that I will, because of the arteriovenous communication channel, the complication occurs in these cases. This is another case, 12-day-old girl who was premature, presented with sign of congenital heart failure. So she present with congenital heart failure. So we had this chest X-ray which showing the congestive heart failure. So this is the large cardiac cell out, and the congestion in the lungs. So other pictures, on the MRI, T1 weighted image, there is a large hypointense mass occupying the liver. Then on T2 weighted images, it is bright. On contrast, again peripheral discontinuous nodular enhancement and centripetal filling on the delayed images. So this was again this focal infantile hemangioma. So C presented with this congestive heart failure because of the arteriovenous communication. There is always coagulopathy, there is always pooling of the blood, congestive heart failure. Another case, 10-week-old girl with severe hypothyroidism. C presented with severe hypothyroidism. So here is the ultrasound image of the liver. There is multiple hypodense lesions seen in the studied in the liver, diffusely involving the liver. Again, we can see there is venous porto communication. The mass is having this portovenous portal vein and the hepatic vein. There is channeling, and on CT there is, on contrast CT there is peripheral nodular enhancement, and on delayed image there is little centripetal filling. So this is the third category, that is diffuse infantile hemangioma, in which the whole liver is diffusely involved with multiple lesions. In the multifocal there were tiny lesions, here there are bigger lesions and showing the characteristic hemangioma pattern. In the multifocal it was homogeneously enhancing, here it is peripherally enhancing and then centripetally filling. So another case, basically, so again the multiple hypodense lesions studied diffusely in the liver, and on contrast MRI images it is peripherally enhancing. So these are the diffuse infantile hemangiomas. So of all these three hemangiomas, they have the risk of bleeding because of the multiple arteriovenous channels. So we don't do the biopsy generally if we have diagnosed it already on imaging. So we prefer it diagnosing it on imaging because of its typical imaging finding. And another thing is demonstration of involution and follow-up. All these hemangioma involute eventually, but because of their complication, because of we have to diagnose and treat them. The complications are basically serious complications, which is the congestive heart failure because of the arteriovenous shunts that I said, and the Kassebeck-Merritt syndrome because of the platelet sequestration. There is coagulopathy, and it is seen in solitary and multifocal lesions, the CHF. Severe hypothyroidism occurs, that the fourth case, because of the high level of type 3 iodothyronine deiodinase activity in this tumor. It secretes deiodinase enzyme, which decreases the thyroid level.
Straightforward entity, right? Easily diagnosed on imaging. The biggest mistake people make is they don't take the delay, right? So it's a bachu, it's a 1-month-old, 2-month-old, usually under anesthesia doing either a CT or MR, at least under sedation. And to not do a proper complete CT is a crime. Right? So often we see, right? We come in Tata, we see theta, we can just one phase and we're not very sure. And usually we feel it's a hemangioma, but you know, if you take the delayed, it's convincingly 100% hemangioma, matter is solved. Red currents are relieved, nothing to worry about, it will go back out on its own. So you have to do a proper scan. Okay, in any bachu, you always try to monitor even more properly compared to MRI, because it's under anesthesia. I don't want to repeat that. Is there any MR advantage over CT? I don't think so. I think CT is fine. In the West, they will do more MRs because they are worried about radiation, which I think is stupid. So I think CT is fine, you can easily do a CT. So first obviously you'll do a stroma, you'll see a mass, most likely you will do a CT, do a proper CT. The risk of sedation is actually much worse than this so-called risk of radiation, right? So with MR you need half an hour sedation, don't try to do an MR, rather recommend a CT. And most commonly you will be able to diagnose it. Rarely other differences we'll talk about are coming to the picture. So if it's not a classic picture, then certainly then you need to biopsy or do some other further investigation. Whereas classic picture, you can completely confidently reassure everyone. The treatment generally is nothing, or as he said, lutelong receptors, right? So they give propranolol, and that is supposed to shrink the hemangioma faster. So if the patient is symptomatic, is a huge thing, then they will get propranolol and just follow the patient up on ultrasound. So it will generally be just a one-time CT or MR, whatever you do. After that, the follow-up will be ultrasound. So always take images and save them, right? Because every follow-up you want to see, pehle kitna dikh raha tha, what was the plane, what was the shape in which the photo was taken. And try to compare in the same sort of plane, right? So always save the picture for any hemangioma, right? Or any positive thing ideally, but at least for this case. Right? Yeah, that's anything you want to ask about hemangioma? So this nomenclature is always confusing. Some people call it cellular hemangioma, some people infantile hemangioma, infantile hemangioendothelioma. I think hemangioma is straightforward to say. Everyone understands it. Hemangioendothelioma, as I wrote in the slides, and I think there is also an epithelial hemangioendothelioma variety. So, and it's anyway longer to write it. So just write hemangioma.
So the another category which is the commonest benign tumors, the second most commonest is the mesenchymal hamartoma. So it is predominantly cystic, and it presents in again less than 2 years of age. Patient, a child presents with painless abdominal distension, and prenatally if it is present, then it has hydrops association. So the case is 16 month old girl with abdominal mass. Here is the picture. So there is a skin CT, solid cystic is the whole complete is a mass, solid cystic mass is seen in the CT, and on ultrasound the cystic component has low level echoes and the solid component has minimal less vascularity. So these are basically septations in the solid cystic mass, and on again CT there is two hypodense, that is cystic component and the solid component. So there is mesenchymal component, there is stromal component, and there is cystic component. So predominantly cystic component is higher in the mesenchymal hamartomas. This is another case, 2-year-old boy with abdominal mass. So multiple septated hypoechoic mass is seen, and on MR image there is a T2 bright with hypointense septations, multiple hypointense septations, and T1 post contrast, for the post contrast there is minimal enhancement in the periphery, in the solid component, and little in the center in the septations. So basically these mesenchymal hamartomas are the large cystic, predominantly cystic solid mass with multiple thin septations, and they are on enhancement, they are very minimal enhancement. The solid part will enhance and the thin septations will enhance. So MRI picture, like I said already, all these are written, solid portion, hypointense, and these things. So mesenchymal hamartoma, how we diagnose? So these were the two important benign tumors. Other are the FNH, which are more common in the young adults, FNH adenomas. So this have not
just like adult masses. So adult masses. We have not covered that. But these two are important benign tumors.
Benign liver lesions.
So once you say cystic lesion, then you think of
hamartomas.
And pre-CT, you will not be able to predict a mechanic liver. So for the test, just say, you are dealing whenever there is a pediatric liver lesion. Just do a liver, because you might not be there covering. You won't know, okay, you know, missing care. So for the test, just tell them to always do a liver.
So in the category of malignant tumors, the first important, the most common is always metastasis, which comes from the neuroblastoma and the Wilms tumor lymphomas. The other primary hepatic neoplasm is the benign one, hepatoblastoma. Hepatoblastoma, HCC, fibrolamellar HCC, undifferentiated embryonal sarcomas, epitheloid hemangioendotheliomas, angiosarcomas, these are the rare ones, and rhabdomyosarcomas. This I will cover individually. So sir will be talking about hepatoblastoma later, but the important one after this I will cover later. Okay, I'll just tell. So the differential diagnosis, we have to differentiate hepatoblastoma and the focal infantile hemangioendothelioma. Once you see the hepatoblastoma picture, so there is the well encapsulated hepatoblastoma is like this only, well encapsulated mass with the mild enhancement in the mass lesions. There will be chunky calcification in hepatoblastoma, but in that focal, which I already talked about, hepatoendotheliomas, there will be the fine calcifications can be present, and enhances much more than the adjacent parenchyma. This enhances much less than the adjacent liver. So hepatoblastoma will be the mass which will not that enhanced than the surround. It will be hypodense basically. But this IHE will be enhances more than the liver parenchyma. And there, like we saw, this nodular corrugated peripheral enhancement in this IHE. And whereas we can confuse this with hepatoblastoma, but there will be less enhancement. There will be trim enhancement. And AFP levels are always correlated. So the other important variety is fibrolamellar HCC. So it is basically presented in less than 35 years of age. AFP will be normal, and there will be central scarring. So it will be a hypointense T2 hypointense scar, and there will be no underlying hepatic disease. Like in HCC, we see always there is cirrhosis, there is underlying disease, the viral infections, but in fibroamylar HCC, there will be no underlying liver pathologies. So here is the picture of fibroamylar variety. So this histology is showing basically collagenous scar in the center, and this is a large hepatic mass. On the plain CT, it is less hypodense. On contrast, the central area will not enhance, the peripheral it will enhance. On delayed images, again, the central area will never enhance because it is collagenous. So it will, the surrounding periphery will enhance with non-enhancing central scar, and there will be calcification, and calcification can be present in the central scar also. So here, this is the MRI picture. So on T2, it is hyper intense than the liver parenchyma, and on T1, it is hypo intense. Post contrast, it will enhance with the central non-enhancement scar part. And on delayed images also, the central will not enhance, the other areas will. So if you have already read this FNH, we have to always differentiate FNH from fibrolamellar, because FNH also, if it is a large mass, well circumscribed mass, there will be central scar. So the difference between FNH and fibrolamellar is this, in FNH, the central scar is vascular basically, it is not collagenous. So it will enhance, it will be T2 bright. The central scar in FNH will be T2 bright, and on delayed contrast images, the central scar of the FNH will enhance because it is vascular, it is not collagenous in case of FNH. But in fibrolamellar, no matter what sequence, it is always hypointense. So this we have to take in picture. So this is basically FNH. I just put the slide because on T2 weighted image, we can see the scar is bright on T2 weighted image. And then on T1, and this is on post contrast, and this is delayed. On delayed image, there is little enhancement of the central scar. So it will be not always hypointense on in the FNH.
I think more than enhancement, the intensity of the scar is sort of more useful.
It is bright.
Even fibrosis can enhance on delayed, so we can't be very sure. And often it will remain hypoenhancing compared to the rest of the lesion, right? So we are always comparing with the rest of the lesion. So it might remain hypointense or hypodense. So more than the enhancement, it's this T2 signal. Even the RT enhancement. So FNH generally is very homogeneous, diffuse enhancement, right on the arterial phase. That is generally not going to happen with fibrolamellar. And so we talked about three lesions with calcification. Anyone talk about the three lesions which have calcifications? Hepatoblastoma. Yes, and fibroma. So three lesions usually in Bacchus can have calcifications. So hepatoblastoma, as you said, is generally more chunky calcification. But they can also be punctate tiny calcifications. So not necessary that it is chunky all the time. So hemangioendothelioma will generally be punctate if it is there. So then the pattern is not 100%, so it's more of the enhancement pattern, which is more important. The calcification is not important. FLC, however, is very unique. So the calcification generally only the scar, they won't be in the rest of the tumor. If you see a central scar with calcification, is fibrolamellar HCC, it is not FNH. Okay.
The second category is undifferentiated embryonal sarcoma. So this present in 6 to 10 years of age, it is rare below 5 years of age, and it is predominantly solid, and it contains cystic and mucoid component as well, and it mimics cyst at MRI that I will show you in the picture basically. So this is case, 8-year-old boy presented with pain in abdomen and discomfort. So this was the CT picture of it, showing a hypodense mass largely occupying the right lobe of the liver. It looks like a cystic, large cystic mass with few internal septations showing enhancement. And on ultrasound, it was expected as cystic mass, but it come out to be a hyperechoic heterogeneous mass. So it appears solid on ultrasound, cystic on CT. So this is the characteristic imaging appearance of undifferentiated embryonal sarcoma. On this MRI, T2, it is bright, and there are few bright areas because of the hemorrhage and the mucoid component basically. So in undifferentiated embryonal sarcoma, there are mucoid gelatinous component which is bright and hemorrhages within. So again, on MRI picture, it looks like cystic mass. And then we do ultrasound, it we find it as solid mass. So this is undifferentiated embryonal sarcoma.
So undifferentiated, it's not that common. You will 100% see that happening 3 years here or 4 years later. But that, this is the classic picture. It will look very cystic when a 5-6 year old baby boy or girl comes with a large cystic looking mass. Outside, if something like this happens, it will be always called an abscess. Yeah? They will sometimes tap it, drain it. That is actually a brain. So, the ultrasound is actually more useful than CT, right? Because ultrasound, no one will ever call it an abscess. So, if you directly do a CT, you might, radiologist outside might call it an abscess. But you know, patient will not have fever, because they lumped in the abdomen, sometimes some weight pain, certainly not fever. So, that is not a the history, which will give you the answer that it's not an abscess. It's a very dirty, aggressive tumor. So, if it's not managed properly, people will die very soon. So best thing is to diagnose correctly at the first go, you know, quickly do a biopsy or whatever, and then resect the entire thing if possible. That is the best chance of baby as for survival. Right? So it is difficult, you know, for a radiologist, having heard of this entity, this is always going to be an abscess. So you can understand why people call it an abscess. This has happened many times in Tata. They've come from outside, being called an abscess. But it should not happen, because the biopsy, if they do, will not be telling, will be on the ultrasound, right, most of the times. And that time you should clearly say that this is solid. You cannot, you know, so that should not happen. But it's an aunt menu. So if, you know, this can be shown in exam, especially in Tata, it's an aunt menu.
The other category is epitheloid hemangioendothelioma. The infantile one was the benign one. This epitheloid is the malignant one. So this is it has got intermediate malignant potential. There is one entity called as angiosarcoma, which is highly aggressive. This is in between the infantile hemangioendothelioma and the angiosarcoma. It has the intermediate malignant potential. It has central hypocellular portion. So like in the infantile, central will be less enhancing always. Central hypocellular portion, and the enhancement will be confluent peripheral nodular enhancement, and it will have the capsular retraction. I will show you the picture. So this is the 15-year-old girl with right upper quadrant pain, hepatomegaly, and weight loss. So this was her CT picture showing a peripheral subcapsular mass with areas of capsular retraction. So these are the capsular retraction on T1 and on T2 evaluated images and post-contrast images. It enhances, but central part will be non-enhancing, little non-enhancing. So the characteristic feature to diagnose infantile hemangioendotheliomas are it will be multifocal, and all these multifocal lesions may confluent and may be separately, and there will be subcapsular location, and when subcapsular location, it will retract the capsule, so there will be subcapsular retraction as well, and there will be central non-enhancing areas. So these are the picture to diagnose infantile hemangioendothelioma. This I have already discussed. That's it.